Away everyone, this is Craig Oliver. As you know me as Olly. I'm today with Joshua, Josh Hendricks, Jono, do you say, how is it?
Joshua Jono.
So obviously, as you guys know, we've been speaking about the show that we're gonna have together. And we've been on the field almost every weekend, so it's always been a bit tough for us. Obviously, both of us work in the week. But we finally had a bit of an off weekend, I would say.
Yeah.
Is it international break? What is this?
No PSL games.
No PSL games.
Cup games, basically.
Yeah. So it's kind of a break for us. We just came from a friendly game that we were watching. So yeah, we're just gonna basically do some intro about each other, talk about some football going on in Cape Town at the moment, up and coming tournaments, the under 20 squad for South Africa. And just some other topics as we go along. So firstly I'm gonna let Josh take the floor. He's gonna tell us, obviously most of you guys know him, but you don't know him in depth like I do. So he's just gonna give us a bit of his background and how did he end up doing what he's doing today, and then we'll take it from there. Cool.
Yeah, you know, I'm always short and sweet, so basically like I always tell people that it happened by mistake, man. I found myself like not knowing like what to do after school, basically.
Mm.
I tried a couple of things and it didn't work out, man.
Yeah.
And so I saw this insert in the newspaper about an internship at Soccer at Duma.
Okay.
So I thought, okay, let me try this, because they said if you submit articles, you get the internship. But then I found every week, like my article would be in, man. I was like, but is this like by coincidence? So
yeah,
I can see, like on the website, there's a lot of people submitting stuff there. But now, why my stuff? So that's where it basically started. And I went to the engine. I got a call to say that I want to scour the engine. And from there, I think it was like 2018, 2019, I just started just continuing writing. And you're sitting with me.
We didn't meet at the engine, we met at the Bayhill.
At the Bayhill, yeah.
And I think this year would be the second year.
No.
Third. We met in 2022.
We've been twice at the Bayhill.
Yeah, but I mean, that's why I said, didn't we meet in 2022?
The first time we weren't there like together as
friends. Yes, we didn't meet each other.
And the second time we knew each other,
This would be the third year as well. Okay, so we obviously we've been really into the game, deep into the game. We discuss so many things. We literally talk every day, guys. We talk every day, whether it's a joke or whether it's something happening.
80%
football. And we tend to agree on a lot of things.
And we also disagree on a lot.
I don't think
a lot. I mean, Ollie's very, how can I say, he's a caring brother. So he likes taking care of his players. Where I'm more objective.
Correct.
Because I maybe have a slightly more background.
Which is awesome, because that's how you learn.
The players need to.
Exactly. No, obviously, then that's how you learn more from each other, is that if you're diverse. We've been I think maybe because you support United, I'm not sure. We got a bit of a link.
We agree.
But we agree on a lot of things about United. Awesome. I'm not sure if I should do an intro. I think most people
probably know you, but just give us a small intro in terms of where it started, you know.
I think I'm gonna skip the whole schooling part. Look, I've always been into sports. I don't even come from football. I think people tend to think I was like an ex-football player. They always ask me, do you play football? I'm like, no. Look, I played football growing up, but I didn't go to school where there was football. So I was very athletic. I was doing obviously cricket, rugby. I was very good in rugby. Tennis, golf. I even played golf. Did some swimming. I literally did everything.
That's a lot.
Yeah, which is not a... I don't know if it's a good thing or bad thing, because
it's a good thing for me.
Because if you look at it, if you could take all that six sports you're playing and put it into one. Because if you look at, for example, let's take a player, a diverse player, a utility player, like isn't his chances like lower if he isn't just focused on one position?
Yeah, but because I feel like as you're growing up, you should play a lot of sports, because you're exercising a lot of things. Different streets.
Yeah, that's a good way of looking at it.
And it makes you, when you eventually choose, you're more rounded, you understand?
True. Well, that's another aspect of
that's
it.
That's why you get a person like Ozil Gibbs.
You could choose.
You could choose. He was.
And he was even a brilliant player.
I think those things made him that player, you know.
Yeah, so I'll skip all that.
When was the first time, like, tell us the first game that you shot?
Was it the Bayhill? So obviously the Bayhill was my first. Look, as a coach, when I was at Evan Rangers, I was always like the guy. I even got myself a nice phone so I could take nice videos of the boys and photos. So we started this like 7 years ago. Yeah, and then I thought, you know what, let me do something, because I thought like no one's doing it. So let me just like because players see, we even implemented stats on pay. We had a player writing down the assist and how many passes, like players, and you could see the difference in the way the players were playing. So, and you're having them on video and coach, send me that video, or coach, send me that picture. So, you know, that was weird. Actually, I would think where it started as the thing I'm doing now. But I've always, as a youngster growing up, I've always been the guy taking the photos. Like with my phone, I was always like the guy.
Taking out my phone.
Like I just love creating memories for people. And I remember there was a year where I printed literally everything I took for the year. I put it like on my wall. So like when my friends used to come to my house, they used to see this. They was like, yo, where am I? So they used to find themselves on the wall. So I think it's probably started there already. I didn't know where, and because through my life I was always, should I do this, should I do that? I was always scared of taking the chance in this or that, you know. So for me, obviously, but I've always been football minded. I think if you know sports, you would know football. I think in general, if you know all types of sports, I think that I'm very diverse in that. So the thing with the shooting started obviously at the Bayhill 2 years
was
ago.
Was it that when
I just
met? Is it that?
Yeah, okay. I decided I want to. I said, dude. Actually, it was all about making videos. It was actually creating profiles of players. But then I thought to myself, let me get myself a camera that does videos and photos. So I did a couple of videos, but then I was like, I saw the potential of the camera and I was like, you know what, let me just do this. Because I thought, you know what, players love seeing themselves in a photo of themselves.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I would have loved it. I never got the chance because no one looked at us that way back then.
But it's weird, like, you know, because of that, you know, there's such a lot of photographers now.
Yeah,
it is,
yeah, exactly. So. I thought, you know what, I see a lot of work that's the same, so I thought, let me do something different when I do this. Mm-hmm. And there's always a saying that I take from Michael Jordan, and it says like, to stand out, you have to be different, you know. And I think if I look at my work, I'm not trying to boost myself, but if I look at my work or the things I do, I try to do things differently. I try to take my time with the stuff, because I always tell the players, you know, perfection takes time, because I would like to perfect the picture. I would like to make sure that edit works for that picture.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of the criteria that I created for myself. And I think that's also why people now know what lithic lens is, because it is different, you know. So, and then basically that's it, I think, in terms of, but I mean, in terms of the football, I love connecting with the players. As a coach, I only had 20 players to connect to, but now with this, I can connect with so many different players which around the whole of Cape Town, some obviously out of Cape Town as well, which is such a nice thing. I think I feel blessed every day when I see a player maybe message me or phone me or a parent or something, ask me for something or advice. Look, I'm not always right. But I won't give you bad advice. I don't feel like I will give you bad advice.
Obviously, your opinion is based on your experience.
Exactly, yeah. So, and also I said to people like you that I know, that know the game, that also the things you taught me. So that also helps a lot, because I'm always open to learn. So, but yeah, that's my long intro.
Long and short.
Long and short. So what do you want to take on first?
Let's say, I think that we should do like just a general, maybe you can focus on Cape teams.
Okay, cool. So,
who do you think is doing the best at the moment between Stellenbosch, Cape Town City, and Cape Town Spurs? Obviously,
in terms of PSL,
in terms of like,
or in terms of
a club as a whole, we also on the log. Obviously, you want to look at the log.
Yeah.
Look at the club.
Yeah.
It's a reflection of how they're doing. Also.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think in terms of it's interesting because we obviously know the Cape Town Spurs, Ajax back then. They basically started.
Yeah.
This whole thing. There wasn't a Stellenbosch, there wasn't a Cape Town City.
Yeah.
You know, so they kind of, when they moved away from Cape Town, from Ajax, they still kind of kept that structure, but obviously certain things had to change. We can see that. So they were also promoting young players all the time, you know, as we remember, and that's why people would love the kids to have gone there. So, but if I look in terms of structure, I think obviously Cape Town City, they've got a very good brand. I would say they run a very good brand. Yeah. Even if you look at their social media pages, it's like up level compared to the others.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's the way where we're headed now in terms of how people are attracting clubs and things like that. I'm not sure. If you look at Stellenbosch, I think they're trying to get there.
Yeah, but Stellenbosch, they're more focused on the playing side of
yes,
the game.
Correct. Correct.
And then also putting in the right structures in terms of like hierarchy.
Yeah.
You have your chairman, your head of recruitment, stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's been put in place, you understand? And I'm not saying Cape Town City doesn't have that.
Yeah.
They obviously do have that.
Yeah.
But you can see on the field, when a Stellenbosch player comes into the team, puts in like
I would say maybe they're a step ahead.
City, I would say a player does fit in, but it takes him a slightly longer to adjust. See, that's the thing.
What do you think it is? Do you think it's structure, or do you think it's actually players within the squad that can affect that player fitting in?
That's a good question. I would say it's like if we compare the DDC of Stellenbosch to the top team, similar.
Yeah, that's why.
But at Cape Town City, they play, and the DDC, they play a different brand of football. You get that?
Yeah.
But I would also say at Cape Town City, they try to play two different types of football. If you watch the full game, 90 minutes of Cape Town City, they won't play the same type of football the whole game. They adjust. Like I'll compare Eric Tinkler to like someone like Graham Potter, who you can't see what type of football he's playing or the type of structure he's playing. The formation might look the same, but the ideas change throughout the game.
Is that good or bad?
It's bad for the young player because maybe they don't know
what to do.
Because maybe tactically they're not that mature, you understand?
Yeah.
But obviously Tinker's not gonna tell a player to do something that they can't do.
Yeah.
So what Tinker normally does is against the big teams, you throw the youngster in.
Yeah.
And you always see the youngster always plays.
Always plays well, that's what I was gonna say.
That's a nice thing. And then often that youngster has confidence.
Yes.
Which I can admire him for, you understand? Yeah. Like, not a lot of coaches will try that.
But going back to my own question, I think why I asked is because I've seen, because obviously I sit obviously behind the poles, and you know where I sit, you feel it, you can see it through the camera, you can see what's going on, you just pick up things that maybe other people won't pick up. And I've seen a couple of instances where senior players would maybe not talk the right way to the younger players. And I think that's also where I see how their game gets affected.
I always say, the way you speak to a youngster, you must actually know because I mean I can shout at you, you'll be fine with it.
Yeah.
But maybe I shout at someone else.
Yeah.
And he's maybe has a different personality.
Yeah.
You understand? But then it's also the other side where the 18-year-old must also understand it's a senior football.
No, of course, yeah.
So things are different,
It's tricky, yeah.
It's a double though. You have to find the balance, man, you understand?
Yeah. No, because I've looked, like some example, I looked at now Saviwe, who's come through the Cape Town Spurs structure, who's been there since birth, you know, and he's played two PSL games and he's been excellent in both. Is it two or three?
I think about three.
No, the other game was a cup game, so two
that's,
PSL.
That's still
okay,
senior,
I know
but,
okay.
Yeah.
But the two games we watched, he was two, PSL, we chose
it, games,
which was young. And you look at him and I see the first game he played PSL was at Athlone Stadium. And I see how his confidence is in the game, and I can see when he made a mistake. Maybe I could see how the players would just, you know, they would just help him. And I mean, there was an instant where the keeper was speaking to him, and you know, I could see I could almost feel what they were speaking about because of the way they were reacting to each other.
Mm.
You know, and that was good. That was such a good thing to pick up. And he took that, and he took that confidence into the next game. And next thing you know, he becomes man of the match of that game. So they I think that is what teams need to look at in terms of like, how we need to mold our young players into a PSL setup, because at the end of the day, that players must remember they were also young. They were also young at one stage, and maybe someone was hard on them, we don't know.
Yeah.
But I think you can be hard on a player, it's nothing wrong with it. I think it's how how you come across to that player. Because everyone's different. Everyone comes from a different location, a different situation where you know you're swearing at him. You can't always do that with every player. You know. So yeah, I think that's basically back to my own answer. I think it's very important for clubs to have that. And I think with Cape Town Spurs, what saved them and why they're playing so well is because they had an AFCON break.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Yeah.
They had an AFCON break and it helped them a lot because you could see players and almost knowing each other.
And also now you can also then say that, honestly, if you had to start from the beginning of the season, I don't think they would be in the situation that they're now.
Yeah, it's possible.
I mean, it's possible. I'm not saying that Bartlett wasn't a good coach.
Yeah, of course.
But if he maybe had slightly more backing.
Yeah.
In terms of investing in the team, like you can see now, the players that came in, they make a difference.
Yeah.
Especially the left back, it's the left wing back and the right.
Yes,
back.
Yes.
They're making a huge difference.
Players
because, you see, they're not just going forward; they're also working nicely. Back, you understand? And then obviously the change in the midfield.
Yeah, with Luke Byrne.
Yeah,
we never thought that would happen.
I mean, Butsaka is an out and he's a winger. He's an attacker. He doesn't play in the midfield.
He's
you understand?
Yeah.
So I mean, even with Liam.
Yeah,
but that's also
Liam Burn.
Say Luke Burn.
Yeah, I said that's a left back.
Liam. Liam. I mean, he's a left back.
Yeah.
No one would have thought that. Just yeah.
But I think with the modern way of now, with left backs moving into the midfield, I think maybe that's also why it's helping him.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. It's down to the coaching now.
Correct.
You understand? Down to the coaching.
Yeah, cool.
We have to identify the areas.
Yeah.
Put them there. And I mean, we don't know what's going to happen after this, but I mean, you can see the improvement already.
Yeah, I think it's nice because I mean, I'm very happy. I'm very happy that they're winning, they're getting points. The urgency is now in the team, that they believe, because the lack of belief wasn't, that was a big wasn't lack there, of belief there.
Break
helped them a lot. I think they finally became a team that's making it tough to break down.
Yeah. Obviously, you have to start there first, you know.
Yeah.
And cool. Yeah, but we did speak about Cape Town City.
Yeah, now obviously touching base on that, we obviously can go back on to the youngsters that had the opportunity, players that we obviously know. If you start the Cape Town City, you know, there's obviously Kaka that's there, there's Luke that's there, Luke Daniels, and then there's also Sakio. And who was another youngster that came from a BDC? I can't recall. I think it's
this season, I don't know. This season.
Oh yeah, Olam, Fisher.
Fisher and
Lolo. Fisher Patrick.
Lolo.
And I think that's probably the five. And then if you look at Stellenbosch, you go to Carl Jurgens, you go to Titus, Devin Titus. I'm not sure about the Ricky, I'm not sure if he had a run there.
Yeah, but he had a run before he even played
TDC. Yeah,
but
and then who else is there?
There's also Liam, that centre-back.
Yes, Liam, the cook.
Yeah.
And obviously Osman, who obviously passed away.
But everyone is giving chance.
Yeah.
That's a nice
Cape Town Spurs now is giving now more chance. So we've got Sewiwe, Jandre, but Jandre haven't played yet. Reese is in the squad, he hasn't played yet. Obviously, we know Luke Bachman was the first player. And I think that's also so... Almost similar
balance,
in terms of
experience and young players.
Is there any players that you can pick up? Maybe if I can ask you, name me two players out of all the three teams that you feel that could be the next ones that you pick to get a chance in the PSL team. Is it
based
on watch in the from DDC moving up to PSL? If you think maybe just two, I'm not gonna say
more. Pick up a name. Obviously, I kept us because I think Faiz must be given a chance.
Yeah, because he was NFD last year.
Of course. Like his recent performances.
Yeah, he's a bit injured. I think he's injured now, but he's okay. I think he's doing better. And I was selected also for that.
Yeah, so hopefully you also get a chance there. So, but like Faiz is one of those players, and then obviously at Cape Town City, I would say Tosa. I would say
Gabby.
He's one of those players. Is that left back of Cape Town City? I don't know his name, but he's a good player as well. I think he's.
And the centre back is good. Supermandla.
Yeah, Dondolo.
He's also gonna. Like, I think next year he'll probably get a run.
He's been at City.
What do you think about Shakil? Obviously, what do you think about Jody, the striker?
Jody as well.
Yeah.
Now I was coming to Mexico. Jody is. It's just the problem with him is just breaking down.
Yeah.
But if he can just go on a run where he's not injured or anything.
Yeah, because every time he goes on the run, he gets injured.
But I like.
And then he comes back and scores 4 goals.
I just need a full season for that run. That's all. And I'm sure he'll get the call up because I mean, they're all watching him.
I think they're kind of short on strikers.
And if that's what I'm saying. Yeah. If you look at the team, there's place for him there.
Yeah, I think so. Look, Daniels is obviously there and he's an out and out striker. And then Jody comes actually, he's a winger.
Yeah,
he's more versatile. Yeah. And he runs behind the fence. He's got a bit more to offer, I feel.
I think Luke also, he's got a lot to offer, but he hasn't yet showed us in the PSL that he can take that step.
Do you think his call-up was a bit too soon?
Like I said before, his call-up was based on games against PSL teams. Mm. So obviously the coach thought, okay, there's something here, let's have a chance.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
So obviously, maybe it was slightly too soon, in my opinion. But I mean, you never know, we could score in the next 5 games and then...
Yeah. No, he's got good qualities, of course.
Like, obviously, we can see it in the DDC games, he can score, he's in the box.
Yeah.
It's a nice thing about
him.
About him getting that, you know, that moment, that change, like with Luke, with Bartman.
Yeah.
Also, in the beginning was a bit, you know, but then when he scored, different player, understand?
Yeah, it is,
yeah.
Cool, yeah, man. And then Stellenbosch, you think is anyone there that you feel like out of the DDC game? You feel based on maybe the game you were lost at?
Luke Bell, not a bad player to bring into your team, but
who?
Bell at Stellenbosch.
Oh, Zenden Bell.
Zenden Bell.
Yeah. Second name Luke.
Who's the other one now? The left backs was not bad, but okay, they have a lot of left backs.
Yeah, Costa Salero is there obviously as well, but he's obviously not getting so much game time this year.
That's why he's not playing, because that boy is decent.
Yeah, he is decent.
Understand?
Yeah. Do you think Cal Bailey is
Cal Bailey, you know, was you can't be Cal Bailey. I don't want to say that, but that guy, Andre de Jong, he's a big guy. He's playing 10.
Yeah.
Cal Bailey can do the same thing.
That is, yeah. Do you think Kyle's size is still...
It's about opportunity.
Yeah.
His size, I don't care about his size.
Yeah, me neither.
I don't care about his size. It's not like the whole team is his size.
Exactly.
He's not playing in the position where he needs
to be. He needs to have size.
I always say, like today's game is different. Like back then, we need to have strong physical players.
Yeah.
Because the players used to tackle me.
Yeah.
Now you have to read the game interceptions. Exactly. So Kyle is fine. Kyle will be fine there. It's just about opportunity and him being ready to make that step, you understand?
Yeah.
You never know.
Yeah, you never know. Exactly.
You never know.
Cool, man. Let's quickly take a short break and then we'll catch up with the rest of the video. Hi, everyone. We are back. Thank you for still being tuned in. So we've obviously touched base on a few things already. The next thing I want to speak about is the under-20... National South African national team, or the squad actually. I think it's based on 41 players.
Yeah.
We've got, if I counted correctly, 16 players from Cape Town, Stellenbosch, Ubuntu, Cape Town Spurs, and Cape Town.
That's basically all.
Which is all there. Which 16 out of 41? That is
a big number.
Are we heading to Cape Town dominating and being 7, 6, 8 players there in the starting lineup?
Now you know, sometimes they give you a lot of players and then less than half your players even make the squad, so you never know.
Do you know how many players get cut from at 41?
Probably 23, but I think this camp is more a preparation camp.
Okay, cool. Look,
so all of them are pitch up.
Yeah.
So,
despite that, I mean, just to be there, I mean, anyway. Obviously, look. Obviously, we've
because the coach we know close look at them, man.
Yeah. We obviously know most of the players. I know most of the players. Obviously, got took a picture of probably most of them.
Yeah.
But I don't know everyone by name. Like obviously, there's some tricky names, tricky names that I don't remember. But obviously, all the boys from here we know.
What do you make of the team? Firstly, are you?
It's an exciting, fantastic squad. I can tell you that. But there's a few buts, obviously, because you and me, we are at the games, and we don't see. Maybe there's people, I don't know.
Maybe we don't know.
But maybe we don't know, because I would obviously, like you asked in the week, like, how does this players get picked? Who picks them? Do they get a phone call? Look, send me your 5 best players. What do you think? How does it work? You know, so that's interesting.
That's the thing. I don't even know.
Because there's a couple of names that I feel deserve.
Like if I look at these names, and I can say that it's based off maybe tournaments. So
tournaments.
At tournaments, it's always scouts, it's always, you know, Safa people. Mm. They, so that's where they be like big players, you understand?
Yeah.
I mean, not every weekend you expect
but
them
but
to
the thing is this, like, I mean, there was no LFA. There was no, okay, there's Castle, but how many players in here plays? None. I don't know, I'm not sure. Everyone plays DDC or is part of a PSL team. Okay, yeah, Ubuntu obviously plays in the Vodacom, but they've got like one or two, three players on there. So how do they, yeah, so it's interesting because I feel like there's some key players that, look, if maybe I'm looking at it wrong because I look at a lot of things of a player, you know, the mindset, especially from top down or from bottom up. So I think there's some players that really deserve to have been given a chance, you know, and certain players have approached me, asking like, what is that criteria? Like, I don't know, guys, you know, but I got an interesting message the other day, like a boy that messaged me and he said, why do they always pick players from academies, you know? And yeah, and I think I replied well to him because at the end of the day, I said something like, you know, where in the world do you see players that get picked from lower leagues? Mm-hmm. You don't see it.
Makes sense.
You don't see it. I mean, how many good players did in championship? Do they make the England squad?
Obviously,
you know, so that's the example that I made.
Because
that's
just what the coach or the scout or whoever selector is looking at probably is like, what level are they going to play at? You understand?
Yeah.
So we can't pick players that's playing at the lower level,
yeah,
and then expect you to perform at that level.
Yeah.
So obviously we're going to look there, yeah, because it's going to give us a better chance of winning or qualifying, whatever.
So obviously players need to find a way or push themselves into an academy, to make themselves good enough to be in an academy.
And unfortunately, everyone can't play for the academy.
Of course. And then obviously, like, look, like I told him also, like, everyone's time is different. Like a lot of players, even the players who was playing at the academies didn't make it, who's playing well this year. I said, look, your time is different.
Yeah.
You just need to focus on, like you said, focus on your
you see, but like if you're not picked for like the national team, it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
Because there's other avenues, like try to play SAB, try to play ABC, you never know what can happen, you know?
Yeah.
Some of us develop later, earlier, it happens that way, it's unfortunate.
Yeah.
I mean,
I think players who also ask the questions is because players know some of those names on there. And they obviously know some of the names on there, maybe hasn't played enough minutes.
Yeah.
And maybe even some of the names I haven't even played football
obviously
yet.
There's a couple of names here, but we both need
so how do I answer that question? I don't have answer.
That's the thing, like I said, this is based off tournament. So maybe these players played in a particular tournament, they were good.
Yeah, but what about and then your form now?
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. And then now, that's what I'm saying, it's based off tournament football, right?
Yeah.
And then also being part of the under 17 team. So you can see
it, a lot of
there's a couple of players that's been a part of the under-17 team. So now they're trying to keep that continuity, you understand. They know the quality of the player already.
It's tricky because our player wants to...
Wants to try to break in.
He's trying to break in now for the last year or two. He's been hard, working hard. How hard must he still work?
Yeah.
You know, what more does he still do? Yeah, you know,
let me tell you this. Jaden Rhodes, he's playing for the concert team, right? Did you ever see him play for the national team under-17?
What is his age now?
No, but he's 20 or 21.
10 or 21 this year.
But I'm not asking is he young enough.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying he ever played with the national team.
Yeah.
You know, but look where is he now.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So this doesn't mean that you're not picked for the national team, you're not good enough. You understand?
Yeah.
Still need to continue playing. You never know what can happen.
Yeah, no, 100%. Cool. Yeah, look, we're not gonna go further into that. Sorry boys, if we didn't make it, you know, keep on going. You know, don't feel like you not good enough, you know.
Look, it's a matter of
preference. You can't change what's been done.
Yeah,
one day we'll find out what's the reason behind the squads, we don't know.
It's obviously not criteria, but I mean, like, it's also a matter of opinion. Like, this game is full of opinions.
Yeah.
I mean, you might like a player that I don't like.
Yeah, true,
but
of course.
If I pick my team, we'll have a different team.
Yeah, no, 100%. 100%.
So that's how it works.
No, of course. Cool. So we've got upping.
Yeah, do you want to discuss the talents? Yeah, let's look at. Obviously, we go to Sundowns, you're going to mention Mabena. He's not playing a lot of minutes now, but he's
obviously we're lucky enough to see some of them when they come down here. I think we're okay with the limited space on the last time. The thing is, I don't know a lot of those players personally. I just know him by picture on Instagram. But for me, I think obviously some of them are in this team. Yeah, a lot of them are in this team as well. Some of the names I can't even say, but they're there. But I would say it's a very good squad. I would say it's a more exciting squad than the national. And I don't know. I feel so. Because it's so
more
diverse.
More exciting than the
final. It's, no, but it's diverse. If you look at it,
it's
got a lot of diversity, which is the one thing that we lack in the Bafana team, isn't it?
It's good, but I always say, like, put the colour aside. Let's pick quality.
No, of course, 100% I agree with you. Of course, 100%.
Let's pick quality.
And cool. Well, obviously, if you can make a starting 11 out of this,
it's gonna be hard.
Yeah, you can. You can have a try. I didn't want to actually go in.
It's gonna be hard.
But if you go through the name, some of it, obviously, Savinui, I feel, should even be the captain. He's been in the setup for a while.
Yeah.
You know, non-biased guys. I just still feel Savinui is the person that should captain this team. and I think obviously Lazola, who comes from Ubuntu, who's now playing at Supersport. I think he's also been in that setup. He was in the national team last year as well. There's a couple of new names. I would say new names would be John Ray from Spurs, who's a new name.
Yeah.
That came in now. Shaquille, I think he was probably shocked when he got the call. Shaquille April.
He obviously has a lot of minutes in the senior team.
Yeah, so he's also in there. I'm so proud of him.
Also not bad when he comes down to DDC.
So. Yeah, awesome. And now obviously he's playing there with Dakir, who's now by City as well. But 16 boys out of 41.
That's
a lot. Yeah,
that is. And so is. Hey, you got talent there. Yeah, but we know that. Look at Supersport, look at Sundowns.
Yeah.
They know that, like, our academies develop plays in a certain way that they want, you understand? Both tactically and technically, you understand?
Oh, yeah.
So that is the difference.
Mm.
That's the difference.
But anyway.
Yeah, let's move over. You said you wanted to talk about the Bayhill.
What's coming up next?
Give me some predictions there.
So we got the Bayhill happening, 27th to the 1st? 27th? I can't remember.
Yeah, 27th.
I don't even know if I'm going to get off, but every year we got the same situation. But I think Thursday there's some heated games already. Friday, Wednesday is about, one or two good games.
I don't ask that, man, but I want to know who's going to win the Bayhill.
Who's going to win the Bayhill? Oh,
people are going
to come with me.
They can come with me. You must tell us, based on, obviously you had the field probably more than me in terms of the ski and stuff like that, so some of the places there, and you had the SAB games a lot as well. So you must tell us. You know what? Your opinion is gonna be better than mine, you understand? I watched the playoffs.
Well, you were with me there.
I
would like a non-academy team in the final again. Because a non-academy team won the Bayhill. And the stadium was full.
So, do you actually think that can happen again?
I think it's possible. I think based on the playoffs, it's very possible. But I think in the final, we'll have... Can I mention two teams? One of the two. I think in the final, we'll either have Stellenbosch in the final or Cape Town City. That's what I think. That's the one team in the final that I think they will have. I probably lean a bit more towards Cape Town City because Tariq come out into the side of the Stellenbosch. And
he's the puzzle. Why did you leave City?
Stellenbosch.
Oh, because you said Cape Town City.
I think that he's the piece of the puzzle they missed. And I think he's had a Bayhill before. He's been on form. And I think with Topley there, and I mentioned it in the week with Topley there behind him. And I think they've got some nice boys in that team.
You see, this man is biased.
I'm not biased. Guys are now supporting everyone.
Everyone knows. If you look at the Cape Town City team, this man took about two plays here.
And I'm gonna go. I'm coming to Cape Town City teams now. So,
but you must also mention the LFA team that's gonna also show up.
So I'm gonna get there. I think Grassy Park will be again a very tough team to beat. They probably lost a few of the players that was in the final.
Yeah, because obviously you're older.
The West Indies team is in the group of death, but they're not a bad team. Yeah, they're not a bad team. They've got some nice players. But I don't know. Ubuntu's back in the belt. What to expect of Ubuntu? I don't know. I can't say. But if I look at the If I look at a team that we can actually look at here.
I think Cape City is due.
They are due. They had a very good semi-final.
And they also have the players.
They've got some nice players. Yo, plus Emil's probably gonna play his first bell if he's chosen for the team. I'm sure he's chosen. Chody's last bell. Striker complaining all, he's old, he turned 20 this year. And Sandler's coming down. Is Zavi gonna play? Zavi's injured in the moment, but is he gonna play? We don't know. Zavi's coming. That'd be nice though if he can come down and play for Sundowns. We don't know yet. But the boys obviously went to Sundowns.
Usually they do that because it's from Cape Town, so they will try to play.
I'm happy for Greenwood and Letty that came in now. Because Chippa
pulled out.
So we got Greenwood. Greenwood's got a very nice team. That's a nice group, the Group C. Greenwood, FC Porto, and Hope Park and Regas. It's such a good group. Such a good group actually. Regas now hopefully will do well again. I don't know, man. I can't see an upset, that's what you're saying. The quality of the academies in the Dusky teams, Dusky League has been really top. I don't watch a lot of LFA, so that's, I can't really say.
They top, no? They play on the Astro. Now they come to Bayo. Different.
That is true.
You play on that small field behind the stadium, you lose.
And that's why I say the Cape Town, but the thing is, the Cape Town, remember Cape Town City, they play in the Castle League, and Cape Town Spurs plays in the World Cup. They don't play, all the games they play away is on grass.
That's the thing, yeah.
You know, so.
But like I said, a lot of the times you come there and you think, okay, the place is quiet, the team, whatever is right.
Yeah.
But then on the day, it happens.
The thing is also, like, obviously, a lot of teams that qualify have new players coming in because that player's got this.
That's the thing.
You see, look at the Bayhill team, for example. They got a lot of players that didn't make it. That's coming in there now. So like, I don't want to put my mom. I can't really say those things because I look at teams who's been together. It's very important.
Yeah, I think now, we're trying to judge who could win it. But we can't because we don't know who's gonna be there. You understand? Yeah. Who's gonna play with who?
Yeah.
So yeah.
But I definitely think Stellenbosch or City will be in the final. Who's gonna be the people against them? I don't know. Maybe they play against each other.
They win the final loss.
Look, Cape Town Spurs have a decent team. I just feel like that players that three that last year, it's gone completely. The front three is gone.
Yeah, but we knew that.
And Zaviva is gone. You know, they got new players. They got new players that's playing now in the Vodacom League that they came up from outside in.
Okay.
Also, and I've been doing okay in the Vodacom League.
Yeah,
so
not too bad.
So I won't write them off. I won't write them off because they're very good in tournaments.
Yeah, you know.
You know, so it all depends on the structure, the coaching, all the type of things. But I don't feel like they would have the edge. I would think this team now would be the team for next year at the ball down.
Okay.
I feel like last year's team was probably one of the best teams they could possibly have. In a long time, even better than a team that won the ball the year before.
The year before?
Yeah. I would feel.
Front three was buzzing.
Yeah. Jesus.
Front three was buzzing.
But don't ride off Grasberg again. I want. Really tough team to beat. So, yeah, that's my view. I'm not sure what your prediction is.
I don't have a view. My thing is always I want to get to the field, down the cross, see how the guys are. Because you know what? The Bayo is a different level, my friend. You must step up there because for some of the kids that play there, it's like the first time they're playing in front of such a big crowd.
Correct.
Because the Bayo takes a lot of big crowd.
Correct, yeah.
So
the thing is, touching on that crowd thing, so they got Super Sport that's going to obviously last for some of the games.
Yeah.
Do you think now less people will come to the field? Also based on the fear coming in?
Number one, a lot of people don't have that app. So and also people want to go to the stadium to watch the game. You understand the atmosphere? It's nice.
Yeah, I told the tradition, you understand.
So I don't think that will affect the crowd, man. I think more people are going to be, will obviously grow the brand.
I think it will be bigger than Austin.
Yeah.
I think it will be more people. We hope for that. We obviously hope for that. It's bigger. Because I think the quality in football is going to be top. I think we're going to see some top quality again. I saw some top quality in the playoffs already.
Yeah.
So I feel like, I think we're going to step up a notch this year. And I think we have to.
And also like in terms of scouts. Like that stream basically. Yeah. So you don't need a subscription to watch it. So anyone all over the world can watch it, you know. So it's just broadening the brand of player and also giving.
And players know they're being watched. They know they're being watched now, so they have to perform.
You see that all those things, people say it's pressure, the media's pressure, all this stuff.
Yeah.
But it's part of development.
But it is.
Was it?
How is there stuff in our days?
Like, do you don't see, if people don't see, like, how can I say, you're developing a player by putting him in front of media, speaking, journalists speaking, taking interviews, you understand? It's part of development, you understand? That's my main thing. And also, in terms of developing them, how are they reacting in front of a crowd?
Mm.
You know, touching the ball, all that, like those small, minute things.
Yeah.
Because like, you don't want to put a boy in the stadium and it's his first time playing like PSL.
Yeah.
Not everyone will react the same way.
Of course.
I mean, look at Luke. I mean, he had an experience of the Bayhill playing in front of a big crowd.
Mm.
And when he played PSL, it wasn't like a big thing for him. It was just like, if you look at him, it's like, it's not phased at all.
Yeah.
So it's so important for players to play in the Bayhill.
That's a nice time, yeah, exactly. I agree with you. 100% no, of course. Yeah, no, I don't know. I'm excited. Obviously, at the same time, another tournament. There's some good tournaments. Trinitarian tournament, the 14 tournament, which happens every year. Some good teams in that tournament. Then also there's the tournament. I'm not sure the name of it. I keep on forgetting. The tournaments in Cape Town.
I think it's a free tournament.
Buntu's in there.
It's under
16 and under 14.
Yeah.
So there's a couple of good teams in there, which is a nice grounds, a good grounds.
Yeah.
Hopefully I can check it out. Hopefully we can make a turn there as well.
Some good scouts there.
Yeah, exactly.
Agents also be around.
Exactly. So it's a weekend of complete football. Sure.
Yeah, it's important to know where the football is so that you can also kind of attach yourself to teams like that.
Someone actually watched me out of the day. Dude, how do you know where all the games are?
So watch your group.
It's everywhere, you know, Google, whatever, Disky, whatever.
If you want the right group,
right group movement, you can get on their page. They got a nice website where they can also get the games on for the Vodacom and for the car selection. So thank you to them as well. I normally check their website myself to see who plays.
Capture sporting moment.
We get it obviously from the website. Exactly. Now there's enough places for us to get it. We'll see what's happening.
Nah, you can't tell me. You don't know. Yeah.
Awesome, man. I don't know if this is off topic, but part of the topic. But yeah, I think we're okay. I think we're set for the bail. We're ready for it. In terms of, obviously, this is more towards like for yourself. Like in terms of like what's happening in football at the moment in South Africa. There's a lot of, obviously we're deep into the game, so we know more than others, I would say, what's happening behind the scenes, stuff like that. Do you feel like South Africa in general, do you feel like we have still a very long way to go in terms of development, in terms of changing things for the better? Or do you feel like there's too many things behind the scenes happening where people are still doing things for themselves instead of just doing it for the players?
I think it's a bit of both. I can see that there's structures we've been put in place in terms of, you can see the under 20 team now, there's also an under 15 team, there's an under 17 team, you understand?
Yeah.
So I think that there is things happening, but it's also on the other side in terms of, for me it's always start with education.
Yeah.
So if we want our football to go further, we need to educate the coaches because they are in contact with the players.
Yeah.
So that's the only way we're going to get up a level. And like if you look at the AFCON, it's also a reflection of how far Mamelodi Sundowns has gone.
Yeah.
Understand? Because obviously they had a big presence.
Yeah, exactly.
So they are putting stuff in place there. Again. Like people is like getting angry because Sundowns is recruiting all the players.
Mm.
But that is the mandate from the sporting director.
Yeah.
That he wants all the best talent in South Africa. Even on the women's side, they're recruiting men. You understand?
People don't understand that. They just
but now it's like you're doing something wrong.
Yeah,
you're taking you stealing players.
Yeah.
But we're taking this player to a place where they can actually develop.
Yeah.
Do you understand? And it doesn't mean, okay, now they're going to buy the best players, they're not going to play. Okay, maybe they won't end up playing in the first team, but they won't end up playing for another team where they will add value. Do you understand? Mm. That's the difference, man.
Mm.
So for me, it's on both sides. I still feel our coaches need to be educated more. And then obviously, the higher structures in terms of looking down, like you mentioned, the scouting part, how do they scout players, how do they pick players. No one knows how, do you understand?
Mm.
So that type of things must be more open and it must be upgraded. It must be upgraded. Because I don't, like, on the one side, you have people that's doing well, on the other side, someone else is doing his own thing. Man.
Mm.
Not all on one page.
Mm.
That's my problem. Mm. You understand? But like I say, there's a lot of good things happening. And Bafana proved it at the AFCON.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
I mean, who expected Bafana to go to the semi-finals to compete with Nigeria?
We even said they'll win it.
Because I mean, you effectively, you're competing with players that was born in England, born in Spain, born wherever.
Yeah.
Are you playing as Bafana players who are born in South Africa?
Yeah.
And they're competing, man. That's my thing. Like people would say, nah, it's Sundowns players. It's still South African people, man.
Yeah.
What's the problem?
What's
like,
the problem, yeah.
Yes, they would give, they play for Sundowns, but a lot of those players played for different teams before they ended up in Sundowns. So we can also give credit to them because obviously they're also doing something right.
Exactly.
You understand?
That's a very good
so
question.
That's my thing, like there is development. Like it's not always been negative about our football, man. You can see the growth. Yes, we're not perfect. There's a lot of things that should change, but I mean we eventually I think it will change. You understand? It will change.
No, I agree with someone. Yeah, it's a top point you're making there. Coming back on the coaches, like obviously, like when I go to the games, I look at a lot of things, you know, and I do feel like when you speak about coaches that needs to be educated, it's very important because I still see a lot of coaches overcoaching, and I still see the way the coaches communicate with players. I mean, you got like under 10s, under 12s coaches like swearing at boys, like you know what I mean, like so hard on the kid, like.
I mean, it's 2024, but you still coach the same way. That's
like
I know,
for me,
it used to work that time, it doesn't work anymore.
Yeah, so I think that is one thing I feel like we need to change in terms of how we communicate with the players. Look, the modern day players is more soft, I feel. It's more, you know, more players.
Yeah, I feel like it's not even a modern day thing, it's like more a. If you're coaching the youth, you can't speak that way.
Yeah.
It shouldn't even be about what time we're in, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, if you get to senior level, about different.
I think it's swearing is, it's nothing wrong with swearing. I think it's how you do it. Like if you show expression, like if you show like, how can I make an example now? If you don't swear at the player, you must swear like what's going on, like to the ref, or I don't know, like in terms of like oh what the effing goal, or like
one thing a player doesn't like, it doesn't like to be singled out in front of his
don't do that. Yeah,
rather take him to the one side, speed team, and make him understand what he's doing wrong. Because lot of coaches will like shout and swear, but the player doesn't know what he's doing wrong. He's gonna do it again.
No,
swear
of course,
again.
I don't think a player easily get blocked after that.
Education, bro. You want to coach it right tomorrow, but you're swearing.
Yeah, true. No, 100%. Also, they come from different homes and swearing homes also. So you know, for them to come to the field and feel that way. Yeah, yeah. No, 100%. I agree with you. That's a valid point. But yeah, I feel like we are going places. We are going forward. I feel like we are going forward. I just think we're going forward slowly, very slowly. And I feel like there's much room for improvement. The problem is, I feel like a lot of people are still doing things for themselves. I feel like a lot of people forget it's about the players.
Mm.
We tend to always forget it's about the players. And like I said, I almost gave up this whole thing. And I told myself, no, it's not about you, it's about the players.
Yeah.
And that's pushing me. So I feel like we need to put our differences aside and realize what's the best for our players. How are we going to get the best for our players out there and develop players the best way?
Yeah.
Not just keep it here or do dodgy stuff here or doing all that stuff in the background. Like, and treat each other liquor, man. Be liquor with each other. I feel like that's missing. Being liquor with each other. Like, I know Josh does things in the media. He does well. Why do I want to be beef with Josh or Bev? Or why do you want to be? I don't. That is And that is the problem. And I feel like it's too much of that that's happening, yeah. And not too much of this.
The thing is, man, it's either this way or no way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Why can't it be both our ways? Yeah. Let's try to find a way to meet where both of us benefit. You know? Yeah. And it's possible, you understand? Yeah. It's just about you being willing to compromise maybe on one or two things, you understand?
Yeah, of course. 100%. Yeah, no, I think that's it for the day. First one, that's too long, but we'll come back and we'll discuss more things. Hopefully we can do it maybe once a week or things like that. Maybe
2 weeks, whatever.
But yeah, thanks Josh for coming over. Yeah, thank you. Your views is always amazing. Guys, if you see a post of him, please read it. He writes, he's got amazing stuff. He really writes very good stuff. You know, I don't read a lot of stuff, but I read this brush stuff. You know, he writes really good stuff. And I feel like he doesn't get the respect he deserves. But everyone's time is different.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens later.
It is what it is. You know what? If you do something, just do it. Don't think about what people's gonna say.
True.
Know what I mean? You just started doing it. Whatever.
Yeah, exactly. There's always people that's gonna say some nonsense.
And if you're being yourself, you go clash with people.
Of course.
It is what it is.
That's life for you. But yeah, dude, thanks for that, guys. And for tuning in, guys.